and I'm going to talk about the GEGL. GEGL is kind of the main topic of the talk, but what I'm actually going to be talking most about is GEGL buffer, the buffer implementation that GEGL uses. Then I'll talk about how GEGL can be extended with custom operations, and then I'm going to demo some code. When it comes to kind of what GEGL is, it is a library that has been invented to kind of revive the capabilities of GIMP. So the primary customer or user of GEGL is GIMP, sitting on top of a public API. And there's also Ruby, Python, C Sharp, Vala, and there might be bindings I don't know about, but those are the bindings that do exist for how to use GEGL, kind of like on the top level from the outside. And I'm going to return to like how you do that in the next slide I'm showing. GEGL has been written by quite a few people over time. The activity has not been the best at all times, but let's see if I can zoom that one slightly. Thank you. But GEGL was started in about the year 2000 and had kind of like staircase development and big commits to many, many files a couple of times. And it was quiet for a while, right up until about 2004. And then there was some activity. It was quiet again for a long while, until about this time, which is somewhere in the middle of 2005. In the middle of 2005, Sven Neumann and Michael Natterer cleaned up the GEGL codebase, and then I dared to do some commits as well. And then I didn't do many GEGL commits for a while because most time got sucked up by this fish called Bubble. And Bubble is also something that shows up in this stack diagram on the bottom here. And it's one of the foundations of how GEGL actually works when you create operations. On kind of a higher level, what GEGL is. GEGL is a library to create graphics. And I have some graphics here. The graphics I have there is an image of a valley that has been blurred. And on top of this image, I have placed another image. This other image I've changed the opacity of. So, now I wonder why the things I'm supposed to be able to do here don't work. Just a moment, I have to edit the code of this presentation program. This is how it goes when you sit programming during the previous presentation, adding random small features. What could have gone wrong? why isn't this in version control?
Do you have a good undo buffer?
No, I just rebooted. Let me think. Okay. Seems to be working better. The way that I would construct. Oh, there's more people coming. So I've been just rambling about GEGL and what it is and kind of part of its future and past history. And now I'm talking about what we can do with GEGL. Here we have an image with a blurred valley, and on top of it, we've placed another image, which you change the opacity of. The way that is visualized internally, kind of like in GEGL is that you connect a set of elements together to create the kind of overall image. So in the lower left, we have what's called a node, when you kind of like in computer science terms speak about a graph, kind of objects connected with lines, which you call edges. And in GEGL, you can call it an op or an operation. And there we have a load operation, which is what loads this valley image. And this image is then blurred, and that result is passed to the over operation. And simultaneously, we do something else. We load this other image, which is this image, change the opacity, actually turning it down a bit, and say, well, that is the image data we're going to put over that other image, and finally, we're going to display this. And this way of connecting these processing elements together allows you to create very powerful things. You can express things like unsharp mask and drop shadows and many other kind of like higher level effects using these primitives. As a programmer, you might want to do it slightly differently. This is how it, the exact same graph would have been done in Ruby. And it would have been done very similar to this in, for instance, Python. In C, on the other hand, you end up writing quite a bit more code. Let's see, there I fit the actual contents of main on screen. I'm not going to walk through this, but that is the C code that puts together the same graph. Then we have a last alternative or option, which is XML-based file format, which has its kind of origin in thinking about next-generation file formats for both GIMP and for Krita, and because there's the concepts in this file are not really a graph, it's a tree. So starting in the bottom, we have an image that is kind of background layer, then there's an effect layer kind of above that alters the contents that comes in beneath it, which blurs it. And there's a another such stack placed over it, where the capacity has been changed. But what I'm going to talk about today is not how you program with GEGL and these things. This gives an overall idea of what the GEGL is. I'm going to talk about something much, much simpler, what a buffer is. And a buffer is what you deal with in raster graphics, which is kind of one of the ways of dealing with graphics. We have vectors and we have raster graphics. Here I have a lowercase a that has been overlaid with this green grid with holes. And these holes are placed at regular positions in the grid. And we see that we see varying amounts of black inside each of these holes. So we can say, measure the percentage of black that is in one of these holes for sampling a point there, and we assign it a gray value. Another way that looks more like what people call pixels would be this kind of representation, where each of those points is a box, a pixel. We could represent this image as a series of numbers, where I say that something that's black is 0, something that's white is 1, and something that's gray is 0.5. That's what is to the right there. And if I, in addition, know how many such samples or pixels are in a line, I have actually defined a very simple grayscale buffer. A buffer has some other properties as well. The number of levels used to represent a sample in this grid. And the higher precision, the better. Two levels gives it just a threshold image. 6 bits of information gives it 64 levels. GIMP currently has a limitation in that it only allows 8 bits per component, which gives us 256 levels. So we could have 256 different grays in the same image. GEGL uses 32-bit, per component, and I don't know by heart if they're to the floating point what kind of numbers you can represent, but compared to what GIMP does, GEGL is aiming very, very much higher. It aims that it should be possible to do scientific computing with this, not just something that looks kind of right. The last thing that we have with buffers or pixels is color. And the traditional way for a computer monitor to show a color image is showing red, green, and blue colors that are positioned together. So this is kind of a blow-up of a color photograph I have. So if you squint, you will see on the left-hand side there is a color photograph, and I kind of have enlarged a portion of it, and it is just these vertical strips of red, green, and blue. And the way you a computer screen does it is almost exactly like that. You would perhaps ideally want to have red, green, and blue on top of each other. If you mix red, green, and blue, you get white. But that is kind of talking about what a buffer is. The GEGL buffer is the abstraction that is used in GEGL to store images. GEGL needs to be able to store images that are larger than the system memory. It doesn't need to, but it's a neat capability to have, and it makes the kind of design of applications using GEGL quite a bit more future-proof than if you assume that you can create this huge linear buffer and then you do some operation that computes the intermediate sizes based on some parameters, and suddenly you try to allocate 4 gigabytes in one go. So the way that the GEGL buffer gets around this is that you don't actually have access to the actual pixels. The GEGL buffer is something you communicate with. One thing you can do to the GEGL buffer is to request to get a rectangular subregion. And that's what the GEGL buffer get command does. The first parameter or argument to this function is the buffer itself. And then there's the scale, which you ignore for now. Then we can specify the rectangle within the buffer we are interested in, the region of interest. And that is data type that's used in GEGL called GEGL rectangle. It consists of the x, y coordinates, the width, and the height, and then kind of defines something within the bigger image. There's also this bubble format, which is the pixel format that we want to have the data in. So if we had an arbitrary GEGL buffer, we don't know exactly how large it is, we don't even know what, whether it's a color image or a black and white image, but we want to process it as if it was 8-bit RGB values. Then we would specify a bubble format there, which is saying bubble format RGBA U8 for unsigned 8, and then GEGL buffer get would write converted pixels to the destination memory we have provided to it. We can also specify the row stride, which is the thing I mentioned earlier, looking at this, that if we know how wide it is, and that is what we're providing. We're providing our own linear buffer, which is just a series of memory to fill out the data, where you say that each row is this many bytes long. So each new scan line starts after a certain set of bytes. If the Babel format that we specified by chance was exactly the same format that the buffer internally uses, it would just copy data. It wouldn't do any unnecessary computations on it. There's a very similar function called GeglBufferSet, which allows us to set a similar defined subregion of the image. So we could have read this rectangle of ours from the image and modified all the values in it, for instance, taking one and subtracting the value that we found for the component, and then setting it back with a similar symmetric call. The scale is a bit special in that it allows us to query that we want to fill a buffer of a specified width and height, but we at the same time want to scale the image down. So we can provide a scaling factor there. So if you provide a scaling factor of 0.5, we would actually read twice the width of what we're writing out, but we're kind of just scaling it down, same with the height. And this allows the GEGL buffer to provide its own mip mapping routines and very efficiently generates high quality scale down versions. Yes?
Do you have any control over the subsampling that's used when it does that scaling?
Can
you
please repeat the question?
Sorry, I asked if there's any control over the algorithm that's used when it scales up or down.
Not for the GEGL buffer get.
Okay.
It's primarily added there for display purposes. I'll return to similar issues in a bit. For instance, this, which is an additional API call that you ideally wouldn't use much in code, but it is sometimes very, very convenient to have. And that is the ability to just ask at these coordinates in the buffer, give me the color value. And that's not quite as easy as it kind of like would seem at first glance, because if this is my image, okay, no, this is actually doing bilinear interpolation when I'm zooming in, so I'll put it down again. We want to know the color at that intersection. I've blown it up twice here now, around there, and it's like really not kind of really well defined. We're like off center on one pixel, and what does that mean? Does that mean the exact color there? Does it mean something from the neighborhood? And what it actually kind of means is that this image, this raster, is just an approximation of a continuous image. By looking at the surrounding neighbor pixels, we should be able to recreate an approximation of this continuous image and guess which value is there. And GEGL provides this GEGL buffer sample function where we can pass in an interpolation. The interpolation method is currently implemented in GEGL, or in the GEGL buffer actually, is just nearest neighbor and bilinear interpolation. There are stubs for both cubic and Lanczos, but those are broken and bit rotten. For my own purposes, I haven't had the need to resurrect them. The way that this GEGL buffer sample works is that it caches a linear buffer of the neighborhood, kind of behind your back, but it does it with good intentions, because it's very seldom to just ask for a single pixel. So it keeps this moving window that if it already had that window, it doesn't refetch it, so it makes it a little bit faster, but still, this is not an optimized code path. Then there's a little bunch of functions for doing input and output from this, or even creating a new GEGL buffer from scratch. Creating one from scratch, you specify the extent and the Babel format that it's going to use. Loading one from disk would take a file that is saved in a Babel buffer file format, load it into memory. GEGL buffer open is something I will return to when I'm returning to the demos I'm showing later. GEGL buffer flush just flushes any unwritten data currently, and the GEGL buffer save takes a rectangular region from an existing buffer and saves out to a new file. Then we also have GEGL buffer destroy, which for the G object people is a very thin wrapper around G object unref. But this makes more sense to people who don't know G object. What? Yes, Mitch, I was talking to you. There's also some other missed things you can do with a buffer. The most important probably being that the GEGL buffer supports subbuffers. So you can create a new buffer that's a window into a bigger image and treat it as a normal buffer. There's some few things you cannot do. You can also change the dimensions of an existing top-level buffer, but you can also do it on Windows. This is dealt nicely with. Now, I've kind of just spoken about the API interface of GEGL buffer. what goes on internally in GeglBuffer is that the image is sliced up into tiles. Kind of like on the image on the right here, I have divided the image into smaller pieces, which each are, in this case, 128 by 64 pixels. In the GeglBuffer, it keeps kind of one consistent such tile size internally. And we also know the kind of extent or kind of like dimensions of the buffer that stores metadata as well. And we know which Babel format the buffer is using. We also have a list of tiles, and that is all the actual image data we have. For each single tile, we store the X coordinate and Y coordinate. Well, that's not the pixel coordinate, but the kind of the tile number. So the if we assume this is an image that has the upper left as 0, 0 as pixel coordinate, this would be tile 0, 0. This would be tile 1, 0. And this would be tile 2, 0. As a program, we start counting from 0. So each tile is just a linear buffer. We know the X, Y, and set position. Set position is like the way that Google Earth and maps.google.com has these scaled down versions. The GeglBuffer does exactly the same thing. If you at some point use that scale parameter on a buffer to fetch a scaled down version, it will on the fly generate the mipmap tiles needed to represent that. And the way that is done is by merging four tiles on a lower level into one single tile on the level above. This is equivalent to box filtering, and it's not ideal resampling, but it's more than good enough for display purposes, and it's fast. Doing something that depends on more complicated resampling than box filtering wouldn't make it possible to say that one single tile depends on four on the layer below. Then you would say that, okay, if this changes, you have to recompute much, much larger regions. So it's a compromise in that way. For each tile, we also store revision and keep track of what is the stored revision on disk. Knowing the stored revision on disk allows us to delay actually writing tile data to disk. So we change the tile, the data inside it, and then when the tile gets destroyed, then we check, well, is it actually updated before we actually get rid of all this data? And if the internal revision and the known revision stored on disk are different, it will make sure that the disk is consistent. There's also very simple copy-on-write mechanisms implemented for the tiles, which should be used more extensively, but it's not. It's mainly used for the empty tiles at the moment. I'll return to what the empty tiles are. But it keeps a circular list. And if it points to itself on the next copy-on-write datum, then, it's alone about using it. The internal tile API, that GetBuffer and SetBuffer and Sample are implemented using, has the functionality to set a tile at given coordinates, and you provide the GEGL tile data structure together with the data for it. We can request to get a tile. We can ask whether a tile is cached in memory, which makes it possible to write some code that only displays things if it's very fast to actually get to the data, so it avoids blocking. We can check whether a tile exists at all. We can ask the tile management system to remove any trace of a tile. That's the void command. And we have a command called refetch, which is used internally to say that the current data you know about this tile is invalid. It has to be refetched from disk. And there's also an idle command, which is used for the tile system. The caching is a simple, big, global list where the least recently used things get thrown out, and it does from normal caching thing, having a writing dirty data to disk in preparation of actually throwing things away, and does that using that idle call. I already mentioned the MIP maps, and the copy and write for empty tiles works in the way that if you just create a completely empty buffer, and then you ask, well, please give me tile 0, 0, 0, and it doesn't exist. There's something on top of the actual tile backend, which is the storage of the tile, which intercepts seeing that, well, he asked for a tile, went down, and got no, nothing, back as a reply. Then there's this special handler which sees that reply and says, well, I got this empty tile which we can create a clone of and hand it out. So no matter which tile you ask for, you actually get a tile that you could potentially lock and write to and unlock. Which makes the higher levels of the tile handling easier to manage. You will always get a tile. The tile will always be the same sizes. None of this thing that I find rather crazy in GIMP, where you have the effective tile width and effective tile height, so you have to kind of like have special casing for the right edge of your image, where you kind of like cut the tiles in two. So it's like, well, yeah, perhaps we save 100 kilobyte and we add $200 of debugging time. The file format used by GeglBuffer consists of a header of 256 bytes, which stores the buffer information. And it contains the offset into the file where it finds the next index information, which is the index of tiles. And this is index is a linked list starting with the header, kind of implemented using pointer into the file. And for each file, we have just X, Y, Z and the revision, and the offset in the file where the actual tile data is stored, just the raw data. This has kind of grown out of original stack file format GEGL had, which didn't have a header, didn't have an index, was just a flat file with all the tiles. So I offset everything 256 bytes and added a mechanism to write a header into it. This means that you can flush an open buffer in GEGL to disk, and then you can reopen that swap file as a completely valid GEGL buffer. But if you use this GeglBuffer write function, then it will actually write the header first, then the index, then the tiles. And that's a way of writing this file format that is completely streamable because you can read it without seeking. You can just continuously read the entire file from a stream. Whilst the one that is kind of like a flushed swap, you actually need to have random access to the file and seek around on it. One thing that I'm going to demonstrate later is shared buffers. You can open the same GEGL buffer in multiple processes and have changes that are done in one process be synchronized in another one. I think actually I probably should just skip to a demo of that. Because it's quite neat, and we'll show some other things about the buffer. First, I'll just look at the buffer using less. Everything from here and down is actually just padding, but I abuse it to store some human readable information about the buffer as well. It helps myself when doing debugging to see that it's actually a real buffer and such. Now I press the wrong button. So I will launch GEGL with a command that opened the buffer I had already written. I converted a JPEG file to a GEGL buffer. And I'm going to launch another command, which is a very small binary that is going to write into this GEGL buffer an image that's loaded from disk and place it at the coordinate 2030. So I press that, the command is launched, and the GEGL application updates with that thing changed into it. I have another kind of similar command line application I could run. Just check that it actually takes command line parameter. Yes. Strange. Let's just skip that for now. I was supposed to have something that continuously wrote the timestamp in the upper left corner every second. I also have one thing that uses a webcam instead and feeds it, but it's not suited for video at all, and this is very kind of proof of concept code. I'll run a different one instead, which is this one. I was developing these things earlier today under a different distro on the same machine. That's the reason I'm continuously recompiling and fighting some things. Okay. Why should I want to report it? Do I get told about it if I report it? So I'll continue with the demos a little bit later. When things have compiled and I was showing some bits of those shared buffers. The demo I hope to actually show is where I actually use a painting tool in one process and it updates in another. I haven't rigged up something where I have multiple layers and different processes painting on different bits of it, but that's one of the things that can be done with this. The way it's implemented currently is very simple, in that the header of the file contains a flag on whether it's locked or not, and the different processes actually kind of have to poll for this, try to get the fetch to lock. If it manages to fetch the lock, they will write a new index to the file and write a new revision to the header, and then the different other processes will reload the index and compare the revisions of each tile in the new index with the current index, and then issue commands inside the cell saying that, well, these tiles have changed, these need to be refetched, and the information about invalidated regions also can be passed on to the application itself to be dealt with. There are currently three backends for GeglBuffer. It's a file backend, which is what I've been talking most about. There's a directory backend, which stores each tile as an individual file. At the moment, it stores a raw buffer. It might change there to actually use ping files, because that would make it possible to do hacks like Sumify or Google Maps directly from the stored representation, which is what I did in an earlier prototype for GeglBuffer. There's also the memory backend, which is kind of like the file backend, apart from it actually just continues to allocate memory on where to store things persistently. The memory backend is mostly for debugging purposes and being able to run Geggle without touching disk or flap. The to-do list for GeglBuffer is kind of long. Sharing buffers over the network. What I've outlined about sharing buffers is something that can be extended to work over the network using that tile-based protocol or some similar mechanism. And this is something that I want to be quite interesting and want to play with. The samplers should be more considered resurrected and improved. There's a problem with the sharing of buffers that it depends on features that are not available in GIO, the kind of glib abstraction for handling file system and input and output. So to actually make those things compile, I have to have a local modified version and have to figure out a way out of that or port GeglBuffer away from GIO again. GeglBuffer doesn't currently implement iterators, like utility objects to traverse it in special ways. Some iterators are not strictly needed with get and set. It's like you won't call a scan line iterator, you could just read and get one line at a time, and GeglBuffer will do efficient things with it. But sometimes you want to iterate over all the pixels in image and just one pixel, and then it makes sense to actually provide kind of like tile by tile access or a way to abstract that. It probably will not be iterators. The second thing I'm going to talk about in this presentation is how you can extend the functionality of GEGL itself. And that is how you write plugins for GEGL. In GEGL, we kind of looked initially at these nodes in the graph. And what I have visualized here is node like the over node. It has one output and two inputs. The operation is actually an object that exists inside the node. They're separate objects. When you have a node, you can say that, well, you're no longer supposed to be a blur node, you're not supposed to be a threshold node. The node doesn't get destroyed, but the contained operation does. This allows you to have a persistent graph and a nice program model where you don't have to kind of like remove nodes and insert new nodes and rearrange those things. Properties are relayed from the node to the operation. Properties are things like use controllable values like the level to threshold on as a numeric number. There is quite a few operations already implemented in GEGL. I think there is actually more than 100 at the moment, but more are always useful, and they are getting quite easy to write. This is not how we write a GEGL operation. This is the base class that all GEGL operations derive from, and it is the essential API on how the operations communicate with GEGL. We skip that one and rather look at that subclass where most of the things from GEGL operation has been done already, so we don't have to do it. And this is a GEGL operation subclass called GEGL operation filter. A filter is an operation that has one input pad and one output pad. And instead of having a rather cryptic description of the process function, the actual workhorse of the operation, it has a nicer one. We have the operation as the first argument, and then we have an input buffer we're supposed to read from, and we have an output buffer, or a GEGL buffer, we're supposed to write to. And we also get passed the region of interest we're actually operating on. There's an even simpler version of the operation filter, and that's the point filter. A point filter has the additional constraint that every single output pixel depends only on the values of the same input pixel. This is like brightness, contrast, levels, threshold, adjusting the white balance, gamma correction, any kind of global adjustment. For this one, we don't even deal with GEGL buffers, we just deal with linear buffers. So, for instance, if we were doing an invert operation, which is a point filter, the process function could look like this. We have the in buff and out buff, we just assign some float pointers to them, and then we go through all samples. For each component, we fetch the current value, we say that, well, the new component is 1 minus what it was. We assign it to the output, and for an invert operation, we would want to keep the alpha, the transparency, the same. So we just say that, well, the alpha component of the output pixel equals the alpha that we had on input pixel. And then we increase the in and out pointers by 4, which is kind of the 4 components. This is the way that it's normally implemented in GEGL. There's one more function that you can override, which you probably would override if you use the point filter, and that's the prepare function. The prepare function is called when all knowledge about the graph is there. We know all the properties, we know most information, but you might need to do some internal bookkeeping. So the prepare function allows us to say that on the input, we have a Babel format of RGBA float, and we write data of the same format. And that's the reason we just make the assumption that these are float pointers, and we got RGBA data. And Babel does then the work, if this wasn't a floating point 32-bit RGBA buffer, to do our conversions. The way these things are tied together is that you initialize the class of the plugin. And this is more or less standard G-object boilerplate code. And here we have a brightness contrast instead as an example, where we define that we have contrast and brightness as properties with translatable strings. We have the range of them. This is a kind of special dialect of C that avoids the amount of verbosity you need to do to create a subclass with GObject. So we specify that this is an operation of type point filter. We had a prepare function we already saw. We have a process function, in this case operating using these brightness and contrast arguments that we had. And the actual class init function, where we assign the process and the prepare, we say which categories this operation belongs to, and that's all of the code needed to do the brightness and contrast. Let's see, and zoom out to make it fit on screen. It's not that much code, and at least half of it is the actual process function itself. There is another base class available for us, which is the source operation, where we would implement file loaders, and there's the video for Linux operation, which loads from a webcam, and there's a Mandelbrot renderer, and such. What they need to do in the process function is to set the region of interest in the output GEGL buffer. And that's all the work needed to do there. I'll just skip that example. A sync operation is a kind of something that writes the file, perhaps writes an existing GEGL buffer, just displays something on screen. And it gets passed the region of interest, and the buffer is supposed to read from. The composer operation is very similar to the filter, but here we have two inputs. And we have the point composer, which is a variant of the same. And the last kind of specialized base class we have is the area filter. And it seems kind of simple to have this base class, which is a filter, but the only thing particular about it is that instead of being a point-based operation, the value of an output pixel depends not only on that single red pixel, but the pixels in the neighborhood. So the 8 pixels around the center pixel as well, for instance. The problem with this is that in GEGL, since it evaluates just parts of the image and not all of the image at the same time, we need to know which dependencies also have to be computed, and that's where the functions for get invalidated by change which kind of like says, this data change on buffer on your input pad, what chain, what is invalid now on your output pad? And in the same way, we have required for output, where we can ask, if you are going to render, nothing to draw it. If you are going to render subregion here, what the data do you need to be available on a specific input pad? And that, for a blur filter, for instance, is larger than the output region. And this is what the operation area filter provides us. It provides us with the ability to set in the instance. We can do this in the prepare function, for instance, as a response to a radius property. Say that we need this many pixels to the left, this many pixels to the right, this many above, and this many below. And the GEGL operation area filter class will implement the needed kind of like get invalidated by change and recurse it for our output. There's one more thing that has been added recently to the GEGL operations, and that is the ability to register alternate versions of process function. Up until now, I have only kind of like focused on precision in GEGL, and this changes that quite a bit. This allows you to write obfuscated, unreadable code that runs super fast on your machine. It might not even be highest quality, though you should kind of strive for high quality in processing functions. And it allows you to do things like SIMD code as well. So this is, I'll actually just open the actual brightness contrast function which is, I have there. Brightness contrast is the operation that's most heavily commented in the source code of GEGL and kind of how it works. And it also contains an optimized version that is optimized for UltiVec or SSE2 or MMX or ARM multimedia extensions or something else that GCC supports. Traditionally, in many, many projects, the way that such optimized code is introduced is by hard coding it for a specific architecture. GCC has gained the ability to actually operate with vectors itself. So in the headers that get included for a plugin, if it's compiling with a recent version of GCC, the defined hasG4float will be defined. G4float is a data type that is basically the core pixel of GEGL. It's four 32-bit floating point values. We can operate on these simultaneously in C code. So I create one that's called brightness, and I assign all the elements of it, that's kind of red, green, blue, and alpha, to be the value of the parameter brightness, and I have 0.5, do the same for contrast, and have a predefined version that's 0.5 in all the elements. Then I go through all the samples, saying that what's stored at the output pointer location is the input pixel minus a half multiplied by the contrast plus brightness. And then I say that the alpha component of the output should be equal to the alpha component of the input. And then I increase my pointers. Upon compiling this code, GCC will, depending on the compiler flags, generate code. If you don't specify -msse-msse2, it will most probably actually compile regular 386 compilable code, but it will do it in a very efficient manner because it knows how the data is organized, and it generates a very nice assembly output for this. If, on the other hand, you have enabled some architecture-specific instructions, like the SSE or MMX instructions, GCC will use those instead. Even if you only have MMX, and you cannot deal with the four floats simultaneously, it would actually put together a MEX code using two and two floats and generate in that manner. So this is actually readable. It's perhaps even comparable in readableness to the normal C implementation. It's quite a bit faster, and it's not tied down to a specific architecture, which is something I like. And the thing I do in addition here then, in the class init, is that I add a process callback to the class, which is the process simd, and here I say g4float as a string that I register it with. That is not quite decided how to actually specify which process functions to run at a given time. And now I wonder if I can run the demo I was supposed to run. We have that open. Where is that invert? Nope. I'm not sure if I'm going to actually make this work now or not. Are there any questions? That's a simple thing to ask compiling.
You might have to do the make install again, so you can just add sudo make double ampersand make install. I think the double ampersand has a higher precedent.
I don't want to sudo make, I want to sudo make install. Yeah.
So if I want to do calling transformations.
So if I want to do transformations, spatial transformations, like for parameter stitching, I have to transform the coordinates. So for that, I have to use the like base operation class or other any abstractions that help me with defining like what kind of input region is required for the output.
For that case, you would for implementing kind of like warping transformations, etc. You would have to provide that knowledge yourself. There is already a fine operations in GEGL that use matrices to kind of compute the values in the actual two callbacks needed to determine the input and output geometry. But at that time, that would be a filter, so you would override the GEGL operation filter class. But you would provide the information about how much larger input you need in a certain pad, or how much larger region of output is damaged by a single pixel or region damaged on the input pads.
Okay, so I need transformations in both directions to
the way it's currently implemented, you need it in both directions, yes. There is kind of like the... You could, for some cases, do it with just having a matrix, but it's not general enough, so I ended up with actually having one function for each direction, because it allows you a greater amount of control.
Okay, thanks.
Yes?
How do you handle different color spaces in the
GeglBuffers? This is actually a question about bubble and not GEGL.
Examples of RGB was sRGB, or could it be also linear RGB?
Well, I'm online, so I'll open a web browser. The color models registered in Babel include RGB with the linear light data and the same RGB primitives as sRGB. It also includes gamma corrected, so you can kind of specify in your format when you build up GEGL, Babel format, you can specify the data type of the individual components, and some of these data types are gamma corrected and some of them are linear. So that's where.
That's operation we defined for the transformation. Those operation, you just say that it's RGBA, you didn't say which RGBA.
Yeah, the thing is, in Babel, I assume that the RGB data is using the sRGB primers. And there's two different forms of RGB you can specify. So now I'm opening up. The net is rather slow here in Poland. This is a list of all the conversions, a matrix of all the conversions which are in Babel. I have the source formats going down and the destination formats horizontally. Where there is a dot in the diagram, like that one, it means it's a direct conversion between two formats. In this case, there is a direct conversion between gamma-corrected RGB, 8-bit unsigned, using the sRGB primaries, to pre-multiplied 8-bit RGB with an alpha component. So that string, R ampersand. Apparently loaded. This one it was. It says it's red gamma corrected, green gamma corrected, blue gamma corrected. That's a list of components, and all of it in 8-bit unsigned. Should be converted to pre-multiplied RGB data that's also 8-bit. Another thing is, for instance, this RGB float. When I write RGB like this, without the ampersands, I mean linear light RGB. And the way Babel internally does things is that it has reference implementations in 64-bit floating point for the color models implemented and the data types. So if there isn't any direct conversions or any path it could take to actually arrive at the same conversion, it can use the reference implementation to do it. Which most of the time is quite slow, but all the places where there is something in this matrix are conversions I have used myself at some point, so thus they are implemented. You also get introspection output about which conversions are in use and what is slowed down your program in case there's actually a bubble that is slowing it down. You can also tune the threshold between quality and speed on which conversions it actually includes. So you would have a threshold on like how much an error you allow it to introduce when doing a conversion. Yes?
Do any functions in this library impose bounds upon the RGB float values? Do they have to be non-negative? Do they have to be less than or equal to 1?
All of both Babel and GEGL operate with minus infinity to plus infinity. This is also one of the reasons that adding alternate processing function, not to Babel, but to GEGL, that would use 8-bit or 16-bit, probably wouldn't be a good idea unless you added a significant amount of headroom and footroom. Because at the moment, using 32-bit floating point as the intermediate format for all the operations preserves all the data. The moment you would add some kind of fast paths for 16-bit or 8-bit,
you'd be clipping.
You'd be clipping. For data within range, it would be the same, but it would not otherwise.
And in fact, the only reason for avoiding sRGB is its limited gamut. But if you don't limit the sRGB values to be zero between 0 and 1, that problem goes away.
Yeah.
You can represent any color.
Yeah, so the default kind of color format that GeglBuffers use, or not GeglBuffers, but the default format the Gegl operations normally request and generate is the 32-bit 32-bit floating point per component, linear-like RGB with no restrictions on the gamut. So it processes high dynamic range images internally without any problems.
But I can imagine strange effects resulting from negative numbers. Like if you had a negative alpha on an image, you would be getting like an inverted image, negative of an image imposed.
Which can also be used to great effect sometimes. You can, for instance, take a drop shadow and say that the opacity of the drop shadow is negative, then suddenly you generate a glow instead of a drop shadow. But I don't see any of the artifacts you can actually introduce by having negative color values as being bad in any way. The masks work, and it makes the code simpler to write, not to have all these conditions checking for it. So the actual checking for the clipping of the gamut in that case would happen when you display the screen and you at some point request that, well, we have this buffer, it might have high precision data, I want it as 8 bits. Then the clipping would be done there as late as possible. Bubble does implement primarily tri-stimulus-based color models. It is not focused on printing. It's focused on perception of color. So it has very good support for YUV, RGB, C-Lab, and such formats, but the CMYK-based things are deemed to be more naive, since it has actually more dimensions than the reference format used in Bubble. I don't see this as a severe limitation for my uses for it, at least. And since I kind of enforce that the RGBs used inside the GeglBuffers is supposed to use the defined primaries, and whether it's linear or gamma corrected, then you can do it actually on load of that data, convert to the real version from a known with a profile. And if you then do all the operations in floating point, you shouldn't be losing any precision. Another thing is that for most of the operations in GEGL, like the compositing, like blurring, like scaling, etc., you actually want to operate on linear light data. You don't want to have some random Adobe RGB profile and blur it. You get a different Gaussian blur on Adobe RGB than on linear light RGB. But the linear light RGB is more correct. And if you adjust the parameters for the linear light RGB, you could probably kind of try to simulate what you do with Adobe RGB, or you would apply a pre-gamma and post-gamma to simulate it. So it will probably at some point become possible to store profiled rasters in GeglBuffers. But for the current needs, I don't need to do it. It's kind of like it's an external problem. Yes?
But would you still accept patches for better SMIC support in Bubble?
Patches for?
For better SMIC support.
Oh, for CMYK support.
Yes, CMYK.
Whether would I accept patches for CMYK support? The current CMYK support is done entirely as plugins. The color model is a plugin, and the data type is a plugin. I have implemented little CMS-based extensions to Bubble as well, doing conversion to specific formats. Whether would accept patches? I don't see how you could write a CMYK extension to Bubble that made proper sense. I do see how you can generate a specific profile, a CMYK image, and do the separation. But I would have to see the patch to judge that. But thus far, it doesn't make that much sense for me for how the architecture is and how I'm actually using it. But if it's something that makes a lot of sense, yes. And by the way, the most recent amounts of code contributed to Bubble came out of the blue from the person sitting there. And we're kind of referring to him as the current Bubble maintainer, which is Jan Heller, which is like one of the people at the as a GIMP team right here. More questions? Yes.
Just a hint. So rendering of HDR content by Adobe is done in linear gamma, always. We convert and to the linear gamma, it strips the gamma content of the profile, be it on a table or a demo. So it's also what I know from Radiance and other HDR packages. Just to simplify the process.
Well, it's the same thing that I kind of said, that it only makes sense to use linear data for most of these processing things as well. The gamma corrected thing is more or less an artifact of the limitations of 8-bit and optimizing what images you can store in 8-bit according to what is perceived by humans. So it's a form of compression, actually, the gamma correction as applied to a JPEG or PNG image. Well, GeglBuffer and GEGL itself doesn't actually deal with any way kind of like how you import images, and so that's left up to the developer on top of it. Well, any more questions then? Huh?
Why did you scare away anybody who's a complete nerd?
What?